Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Anurekha Chariwag, Assistant Professor, Savitribai Phule, Pune University. Today we are going to do the module from the first module, which is Origin, Growth and Institutionalization of Sociology in India. Within that, we are going to focus on the topic Sociology from the Regional Margins. The idea behind this module is to give students an understanding of the fact that sociology that is practiced in India is not a homogeneous model. There are diversity of practices which are then based upon hierarchies of institutions in which sociology is practiced. Thus, the manner in which we practice or do sociology, especially in terms of research, teaching and pedagogy, differs from the fact whether we are teaching in a government college, a regional university, a state university, a central university or various different locations. So depending upon the fact that where we are, our location, both of the teachers and of the students, the idea of doing sociology differs. So therefore, we need to understand that we need to be very, very focused on the complexity of practicing sociology in India. Sociology in the regional margins. Introduction. This module ties together the experiences and reflections of three practitioners of sociology as they teach sociology within regions referred to as the margins. Here it is important to conceptualize what one refers to as margins. In this module, margins refer to the uneven divide with regard to the practice of sociology in India. The divide is between the centers and peripheries. It is important to recognize that regions have their own specificities and histories, hierarchies and discriminations. To recognize that regions have their own complexity. This complexity impacts sociology teaching and research, that is the practice of the discipline. According to Chaudhary, any examination of the details of everyday practices of the discipline, such as teaching, dictating, notes, evaluation, examining, writing textbook, building curriculum and negotiating in decision-making bodies, involve engaging with the world outside the institution. By reflecting on the everyday practices of teaching in regions, it brings to light issues of hierarchy in the education system, politics of university and college institutions, and issues concerning the discipline in this globalizing neoliberal India. The debate of sociology in the margins is based on reflections of sociology practitioners about the teaching experience in different regional locations, the challenges it faces being located in regional institutions. The challenge is not only that of the practitioners, but also that the discipline is facing. The module would use the reflection of three sociologists, Santosh Singh, Pushpesh Kumar and Subrat Nanda, who teach in different regional universities, but an analysis of their experiences and reflections would reveal that it crosses paths. It is important to recognize that these sociologists contextualize the reflections within larger macro structures of disciplinary trajectories of sociology in India and the practices and policies of higher education in India. It is important to mention that the three scholars have theorized and conceptualized the reflections in an edited book titled Sociology in India, Intellectual and Institutional Practices, edited by Maitri Chaudhary. And this book is an important reading for paper Sociology in India. While focusing on the experiences of the margins, it is important to recognize that the margins and metropolitan centers are not homogeneous. Rather, they are further divided into hierarchies of centers and margins. It is very important to recognize this. This module would have four sections. Section 1 would discuss and analyze the reflections of Santosh Singh teaching in Government Degree College in Uttaranchal. Section 2 would examine the experiences of Pushpesh Kumar teaching in a regional university based in the west of India. Section 3 would evaluate the thoughts and perceptions of Subrat Nanda as he engages with the fact of what it is like teaching in an university based in the northeast of India. Section 4 would tie up the reflections and reflect on the similarities and differences in the experiences as presented and shared by the practicing sociologist. What would the students learn from this module? From this module, the students would learn four important perspectives. Understand that there are many disciplinary practices towards the discipline. Many of these practices are based on hierarchies. Sociology in India does not refer to one homogeneous model, but there are a number of practices which make up the discipline. 2. Location of regions impact the manner in which we approach the discipline. The politics of the region, where the region is located, the students, the teachers, the intersections of caste, class, gender, language, and other structures define very much the manner in which the discipline is structured within a region. The disciplinary trajectories also relate very much to the macro structures of national policies on education, infrastructure and funding. And finally, the personal reflections that capture the everyday experiences of dealing and living with the discipline are crucial methodological tools to analyze disciplinary practices. Section 1. Challenges of Teaching Sociology in a Government College. In the chapter titled Practicing Sociology on the Outside Edge, Singh reflects on what it is to practice sociology on the outside edge, referring to his location of teaching at a government degree college in an underdeveloped region up in the north of India. Singh conceptualized margin in terms of region, especially perceives it within the frame of non-metropolitan. Further, his academic training in one of the centers of learning, Jawaharlal Nehru University, puts this perspective in a particular context. Analysis of the reflections reveals that though most of his observations do critically engage with teaching in the margins, this experience is always contextualized within his training in one of the centers as mentioned above. Never does he critically engage with the center itself, pushing him to frame the center ahistorically. Based on his experience of teaching sociology in what he refers to as the outside edge, periphery or the non-metropolitan world, the government degree colleges in Uttaranchal, Singh argues that his location plays an important part of not only how he perceives the discipline, but also how the students learn sociology and how the community views the discipline. This could also have an important impact on the perception and growth of the discipline itself. Singh argues that we need to understand that they do not form a homogeneous entity in itself, that is to refer to the fact that margins are also based on hierarchies. Singh argues that the centers and margins concepts are not so much the geographical spaces, but rather more the complexity of ideas. For example, if Delhi is a center and metropolitan space for colleges and universities in Chandigarh, then Chandigarh itself becomes a center for a college based in rural district of Punjab. In the same way, Delhi becomes a margin in relation to an established university abroad. The concept is relative based on an intermixture of geographical location and ideas generated. Singh, reflecting upon the teaching experiences of sociology for the teacher, the student and the wider community, conceptualizes it in the sense of a lack or a sense of inadequacy in the whole process. According to him, these inadequacies are many and diverse. The stakeholders, the students, the teachers and the community feel that the experience of engaging with sociology is insufficient. This sense of inadequacy has to be contextualized within the larger story of sociology, especially in the context of higher education, with particular regard to humanities and to the unequal spread of education across region, across cities and towns, metros and villages, especially where practitioners and policymakers regard sociology as irrelevant in the present neoliberal structures of education. Further, such irrelevance is compounded by the hierarchy of academics between the center and periphery, which gave way to undemocratic practices that go against the very spirit of equal access to education. Such issues have to be analyzed within the overwhelming neoliberal education practices now being entrenched within the higher education practices. What are these? These refer to the pressure on sciences to become applied knowledge, emphasis on state-of-art infrastructure as leading to better education, the drive towards placement melas or fairs in undergraduate colleges so as to make social sciences relevant in this globalized world, or succumbing of teachers to the project-driven culture. In this, one can add the evaluation of teacher performances through Academic Performance Index, API, structures which emphasize on revenue-generated targets to evaluate the performance of teachers, which pushes them to apply for a number of projects and to write reports rather than to focus on teaching. Singh argues that within India, in the higher education scenario, there are many worlds and these worlds are placed within hierarchical structures. One of these structures refers to metropolitan versus the musafil, based on the regional disparities with regard to quality and access to education. Singh argues that if one analyzes the development of sociology in India, one can argue that there are two kinds of sociology that grew together but were separate in hierarchies. One branch of sociology has prospered in the proximity of a research-friendly environment and in the company of top-ranking academia in metropolitan centers like Delhi, Mumbai and other central institutions. The second range of sociology has struggled to survive and sustain itself and grew in places such as government degree colleges. According to Singh, in the metropolitan centers, the discipline is considered as a serious science leading to knowledge construction and a serious academic engagement, whereas in the Mufassil centers, sociology is considered to be an easy, possible, soft and feminine subject. Singh, while reflecting upon his experiences of teaching in a government degree college, reflects on the absurdity that defines higher education system in India. It is a system, according to Singh, that has utopias such as Jawaharlal Nehru University, along with a large number of government recognized colleges that award degrees in sociology. Here, sociology is highly popular, because it is believed to be about society and therefore requires no library, is self-reliant and largely experimental. Students are not expected to attend lectures, nor are teachers expected to teach, because the students depend on guides. The education system becomes part of the nexus. Singh writes, the teacher becomes redundant, for chances are that those students who did not follow the patterned answers of these guides would end up with poor marks. After all, paper evaluation is also a business. Patterned answers are easy to evaluate, given that most of the time it is a family affair of enterprising sociology practitioners. According to Singh, the issue is not that such practices are rampant, but the fact that they are considered normal and not considered an aberration and an irregularity. Such practices put a huge question on both the institutional and the practices of doing sociology in India. Singh argues that in most of the colleges based within the Musafil centers of India, the state of sociology is distressing. The problem lies not in the manner in which the students relate to the discipline, but also to the way the syllabus is constructed. According to him, higher education structure such as Board of Studies more often than not is highly political by nature, influenced by petty politics of local petty political networks. Singh presents an example which reflects a manner in which sociology is taken to be a discipline having a casual approach. Singh states that syllabus designed by the university for the final year sociology pass course mentions a phenomenon of suicide as an example of personal disorganization, which is a serious lapse given that one of the founders of the discipline, Emile Durkheim, argues it to be a social fact. Such an approach does not facilitate the growth of sociology as a scientific discipline. Singh argues that another hierarchy facing sociology is a difference in perception with regard to goal of universities and colleges. It is widely accepted without any question that universities are for research and colleges for teaching. The difference between them is wide without any real communication between them, and there is a sense of isolation. There is no engagement between college and university faculty, where the latter act as if they are superior in knowledge and position and look down upon college faculty. The engagement is mostly in terms of annual exchange over a seminar or conference. Singh argues that unless one questions this binary of perceiving universities as centers of research and college as institutions of teaching, it is not possible to nurture a vibrant academic culture. Singh, framing a conceptual category of academic apartheid, argues that college teachers with better academic credentials are treated unfairly. This becomes complicated where university faculty practice self-exclusivity, thinking themselves to be much better than the college teachers, and so they do not encourage engagement on academic issues. Singh believes that there is a need to recognize and question the fact there is a preponderance of different organizational structures and therefore a need to nurture engagement between university and college faculty in an amicable ambience between various academic landscapes. Singh argues that such an imbalance becomes more critical when it is further added to the growing question of relevance of the discipline. Globalizing India emphasizes on applied knowledge as useful, which puts applied and theoretical within a binary. In this context, an institutional building is perceived as emphasizing on investments in infrastructure rather than on nurturing quality education. New universities are being established as centers of excellence without much effort being taken to address the concerns of the already established universities, which were in the past institutions of educational excellence. Educationists have reflected on how erstwhile important universities are experiencing chaos, mismanagement, and academic mediocrity characterized by dominance of money, political mafia, muscle power, and increasing political interference in functioning of universities. This picture is further complicated by the increasing pattern of funding in the central universities receiving a major chunk. In such a scenario, what are then the anxieties of the peripheries? Singh argues that one needs to be a concerted effort to recognize the talent and caliber of academics at the peripheries. There is also a need to have more meaningful dialogues between the centers and peripheries and to build bridges of interdisciplinarity between cross borders, focusing on collaborative spaces. Section 2. Reflections of Teaching Sociology in Regional University. In the chapter by Pushpesh Kumar titled Sociology in the Regional Backwoods, a Fictional Rendering, he focuses on three aspects of teaching sociology. 1. Presents and analyzes the perception of both teachers and the students to the discipline. 2. critically reflects on the local production of textbooks in local languages and its consumption by teachers and students. 3. Reflects on doctoral theses submitted. Kumar recognizes that non-metropolitan regional centers are not homogeneous, but rather they are lined with multiple levels of hierarchy. Kumar argues that sociology practitioners in regional universities, while preferring to teach in local languages, nurture the idea that learning and teaching sociology in English language is alien. Immense amount of antagonism is created with regard to teaching and learning in English. This divide is further strengthened if one realizes that there is a great difference between college and university faculty, especially with regard to their training, that it is most of the university faculty that are trained outside the region in English language and college faculty trained locally in regional languages. The issue is not that English has higher quality as compared to local languages, but that a binary seems to have nurtured local and regional languages versus outsider and English language. This binary is increased with the argument that teaching sociology in English makes students alienated because sociology taught in regional languages is rooted in local culture. This argument is not that teaching in vernacular languages is bad and teaching in English is good. Kumar states that even university faculty that teach in English lack professional commitment. The problem is not that of language of teaching, but that of the casualty of approach taken towards learning of the discipline. Kumar draws on Bethe here and states, by and large, the sociological practitioners remain submerged in the common sense of their own environment. Such a divide is further strengthened by the perception of students, teachers, and community towards sociology. The discipline is perceived as soft, light, and is tied to a belief that a casual approach would help us to understand the discipline. And understanding that the discipline is not a catch and that there are few career options available renders students with exceptions to take the discipline casually. Even when there is teaching jobs, it is difficult even for qualified candidates to get selected because of rampant corrupt practices. On the whole, there is not much that pushes the students to shed the casualness of approach and take up the discipline in its rigor. Such an approach, Kumar argues, also has to do with the background of the students. The students are mostly from rural areas. Most of the male students have agriculture or agro-based business, which they believe they can handle along with pursuing a degree in sociology, as it is an easy and a soft discipline. One does not really need to study hard. Girls take on sociology as they believe it is easy and get a degree, which is an added feature in the marriage market. Thus, it is not surprising that Kumar states that a postgraduate degree is an important qualification that yields social prestige, especially in kinship domain. As far as the issue of textbook is concerned, Kumar states that most of the books referred to by the students are locally produced textbooks. The issue of concern is not that they are written in local regional languages, but the fact that the ideas and issues written in these books are colored by the caste status of the authors, most of whom are upper caste. Based within the structuralist functionalist paradigm, they do not integrate countertext and arguments that challenge the upper caste Brahmanical perspective. This is surprising as Kumar argues that there is a strong Dalit activism in the region. But such development is not surprising as the manner in which sociology has been institutionalized, it has never engaged with mass movements that question structures of inequality. The students and the teachers are so dependent on these textbooks that there is a process to introduce a new theme or an area in the syllabus. The demand from the teachers is to drop it as they do not have local textbook dealing with the issue. For example, when there was an effort to incorporate subaltern approach in the syllabus, there was a demand to drop the approach as there are no textbooks written on the topic under consideration. Such practices have led to increased casualization of the discipline. Such practices reflect on the sociological trajectories in universities located in non-metropolitan spaces. Kumar draws upon the argument of women who refer to college teachers as instrumental sociologists. Those sociologists who look upon themselves merely as communicators of available knowledge to the students and not producers of knowledge. For Kumar, such a dependence on locally produced textbook is a sociological tragedy. Why? These textbooks are used by teachers in a classroom teaching and by students for passing exams. The articulation in the textbooks are highly commonsensical, highly gendered, casteist, moralist and lack professionalism. The ideas presented within the textbook, argues Kumar, have the potential to reiterate cultural prejudice and stereotype. To illustrate his argument, Kumar gives an example he quotes from a book on women's freedom. where it is stated that as a result of women's freedom, women have become more freedom loving and immoral. Because of their immorality, there has been growing incidence of sexual disease, feticide, AIDS and suicide. To add to this dilemma, students read this book, prepare for exams and get very high percentages. Kumar further states that this picture is true not only for postgraduate programs but also of the doctoral programs. Analysis of doctoral dissertations would reveal that research students do not engage with any critical literature and no clear reference to methodology, but mostly is a collection of opinions without any analysis. To conclude this section, reflections of Kumar demonstrate that the practices of disciplines reflect the complexities of the region where it gets institutionalized. Hierarchies of academic practices get translated into hierarchies of knowledge, production and consumption. And therefore, any analysis of disciplines has to take into consideration the complexities of disciplinary locations. Section 3. Sociology in the Northeast, Interrogating Margins. In the chapter by Subrat Nanda, titled Sociology in the Northeast, A Synoptic View, builds up the specificity of the region referred to as Northeast. We need to understand the region and recognize that 98% of the borders of the Northeast are international borders. Only 2% is connected to India, which points to the tenuous geographical and political connectivity to the Indian mainland. This region is characterized by amazing ethnic, linguistic, cultural and religious diversity and is inhabited by three distinct groups of people: the hill tribes, the plain tribes and non-tribal population of the plains. Such diversity is further stretched by development disparities and socio-economic inequalities, the result of uneven, unplanned and unsustainable development policies followed by the colonial government and carried on for decades by the independent Indian state. The result of such policies has also led to the region being marked by insurgency, ethnic clashes and political turmoil and turbulence. It is important for us as students of sociology to recognize that using a generic term like Northeast to define, frame and describe a region which is very diverse into a single unitary geopolitical category is problematic and thus needs to be acknowledged. Its diversity, its colonial history and its geographical location makes for a case requiring keen analysis. Understanding and making sense of such diversity is further complicated with the geographical remoteness of the region. The Northeast is linked to India within a thin land corridor, an area of 12,203 square kilometers, the Siliguri corridor, connecting mainland India with the outlying borders state of the Northeast. Such a fragilely connected region was systematically undermined and exacerbated by the colonial policies of progressive systemic exclusion and segregation. The words of Robert Weed, Governor of Assam, to Royal Geographical Society of London in 1944 in a lecture on excluded areas of Assam stated that Northeast India was heterogeneous and the only thing that they shared in common is that neither racially, historically, culturally or linguistically do they have any affinity with the people of the plains or with the people of India proper. If they were tagged on as an Indian province, it was only a matter of historical accident and natural administrative convenience. What does this imply? Barua argues that a problem that the British scholar administrator confronted in the Northeast was how to make sense of the relatively egalitarian modes and habits among the people. Given that the colonial notion of India was that it was essentially an hierarchical civilization, they found it difficult to figure out whether people of the Northeast were outside or inside the racial unity of India. It is thus in this contested history of the region that one has to analyze what doing sociology refers to and what it means to the teachers, students and practitioners of the discipline. Nanda argues that sociology as a discipline spread from the 1960s onwards, but the region has a strong legacy of anthropology because of the large diverse presence of tribal population. The idea of Northeast as a region always had an uneasy presence in the minds, and in this region, nationalism and nation building is a very contentious issue. But such uneasiness, discomfort and disquiet was never reflected in the issues introduced to be taught within sociology. In its process of institutionalization, sociology syllabus presented an unproblematic idea of Indian society to its students and thus continued and reiterated the process of exclusion of the region. Most of the areas focused on sociological courses taught elsewhere. Specific courses on sociology of minorities and marginalized, of the exclusion and marginalization of the region, did not find space within the institutionalization process. Thus, the specific issues of the region, such as indigenous medicine, healing practices, livelihoods, biodiversity, colonial construction of the region, cultural diversity, and such on, did not find reflection in the syllabi. Nanda observed that for most of the tribal students of the region, especially the Christian tribal students, understanding the paper Indian society was difficult. Reasons of discomfort were based on the fact that in the syllabi, most of the concepts dealt with India focused on mainstream Hindu social institutions, culture, values, and religious order. Little or no reference was made to the peripheral or the minority societies of the Northeast. The Hindu social order, particularly the Brahminical order, conceptualized as Indian, made the students feel alienated. Nanda goes on to argue that in most of the cases, both the textual view that focused on Indological sources to understand India and the book view that focused on villages on Hindu mainstream social institutions did not address the concerns, queries, and questions of the students. Adding to the feelings of alienation, students also failed the absence of sound textbook, which made them dependent on guides which were filled with errors, flawed and incorrect observations and arguments. Students perceived sociology as easy and many equated it with social work. Such a perception pushed many of them to apply for sociology degrees, for it believed that such degree would get them jobs due to the presence of large number of national and international NGOs in the region. The situation is better with reference to doctoral research. Nanda argues that in such research, the specificities of Northeast region are better reflected. There are multiple studies on tribal ethnography, tribal religion and culture, issues of ethnicity and identity, conflict patterns, reform movement, student unrest movements and so on. But the approach of most of the research is explorative, empirical and descriptive. He argues that social science research in Northeast in India requires not only proper application of theory and mythology, but also sensitive understanding of local languages and specific cultural context. Section 4. Conclusion. If one goes back to the introduction, one would see clearly that the objectives laid down at the start were fully explored in the above three sections. We now understand that sociology practices are multiple and diverse, and knowledge gets produced and consumed within different institutions placed differentially within hierarchical power positions. For a study of sociology, Chaudhary argues that one should explore both the micro politics of everyday life and the macro politics of institutional silencing and exclusion. This is what the above scholar did in their analysis. They related the experiences of teaching sociology in their particular regional locations within the larger macro politics of the region and institutions. Using experiences and observations from within their everyday life, they could reflect critically on their own disciplinary practices and engage with it. Analysis of the above and interpreting their ideas reveal that all the above referred papers have focused on the marginality of the region. It has questioned the manner in which sociology as a discipline has failed to take cognizance of the specific issues defining the region to make it relevant to the practitioners of the discipline. One should recognize that being away from the centers of education also to a certain extent impacts the quality of education being imparted, because there is less interaction, discussion and engagement of senior scholars with the young developing ones. Especially in the context where sociology is taught as a discipline requiring no thinking, reflection and abstraction, and where the idea of questioning itself does not have space. In addition, all the above scholars have interrogated the issue of spurious, faulty and commonsensical textbook and guidebooks. Despite the fact that all the three were reflecting on their experiences in different marginalized regions, they all share the trauma of having their students and colleagues depend on these textbooks and guidebooks. There seems to be a nexus between the students who do not want to learn and work hard, the teachers who find it easy to use these references as they do not have to read and engage with new ideas, and the market which becomes a profit from the scarcity of good textbooks for the students. Here, the teaching and learning become a matter of rote and routine, neither challenging nor professionally committed. Another important pattern that was similar especially to the reflections of Kumar and Nanda, was that sociology as a discipline did not engage with a large presence of protest movements in the region. In the western region, as argued by Kumar, there was a strong presence of the Dalit movement, and the northeast, as Nanda observed, has a troubled history and occurrences of protest movements of diverse kind. Unfortunately, sociology taught and internalized in these regions has remained aloof, ignorant, and does not engage academically with these movements, leading to the institutionalization of a discipline, sociology, which is irrelevant to the lives and experiences of its practitioners, students, the teachers, and the community. Last but not the least is the issue of language, especially regional versus English. The students interested in this issue should refer to the module on Sociology in India Crisis Debate, where it is discussed in length. But in the context of this module, I would like to state that it is not a question of either or, but both. We have to deal and engage with both English and other regional languages, especially where the language of the regions where we go to study or to teach or to conduct research. As sociologists, we need to write and engage in multiple number of languages while recognizing its cultural context and power hierarchies. As this module was based on personal reflections and experiences and anecdotes, I would like to end this by sharing one anecdote which I believe reflects the state of education we share. My son was in class 4, was preparing for his social studies exam during the time the new state of Telangana was declared. In his social studies book, it was mentioned that India has 28 states. But as Telangana was already declared to be a newly formed state, I specifically told him that there are 29 states. He wrote 29 states as an answer to the question, how many states are there in India? He was evaluated to be wrong. When I asked the teacher as to why it was marked wrong, the teacher said that in the prescribed book, it is 28 states, and so the students have to write 28. So till the time the change is not reflected in the textbook, the students are expected to write 28 instead of 29. What does it reflect about the education in India? We are never encouraged to question, think independently, and reflect critically. It is not a wonder that we approach sociology as something fixed so as to learn by rote and not a discipline that needs to be engaged with. In this module, Sociology from the Regional Margins, we understood from the experiences of three practitioners of sociology who dealt with the region and critically engaged with their own self and with the way they practiced the discipline. It not only focused on the way institutions were built, but tried to link up with the micro politics of their own self in terms of the teaching, research, and pedagogy, and also with the macro institutions of learning, such as policies of education, state and institutions, and the locations of these disciplines. It is also important for us to understand that when we approach sociology, we have to approach it with this whole question of engaging with questioning the naturals, questioning the givens. We need to critically engage as a discipline. We need to critically question what is given to us and also try to understand where we, as either as students, teachers, or practitioners or researchers of the discipline, engage with the issue of knowledge building very, very critically. Thank you.